Bonjour à tous. Alors, je vais vous présenter I will talk today about something which is a work in progress. In fact, a work in progress about the simulation of Gibbs measure for nonlinear dispersive equation for Schrödinger, I mean Schrödinger-like equation. And I will focus on the Schrödinger equations. So it's a work in progress. There is still numerical analysis to be done on that subject. And I hope that people interested in numerical analysis of parabolic SPDs will be interested by my talk. So in the first part, I will talk about Gibbs measure Gibbs measure for Schrödinger to introduce the original paper of Leibovitz, Rose, and Speer at the end of the 80s. And in the second part, I will set up some numerical scheme in order to compute to simulate those Gibbs measure using Langevin method or MCMC like algorithm based on MCMC like algorithm. The general framework is statistical mechanics of fields, statistical fields theory. So why fields? Because we are talking about a finite number of particles in a finite volume, but we have an infinite degree of liberty, even if we have a finite particle and a finite volume, because in fact we have to take into account the whole spectrum, the whole frequencies. It was originated by the black body theory. If you heat an iron bar at 600 degrees red, at 2000 degrees white, and so there is a natural question for what temperature, what color. And the first statistical physics theory, which was a finite dimensional one, finite number of degrees of each particle with 6 degrees of liberty, I've concluded a linear model with a black body theory, and that linear model was not the good one. We have to take into account the whole frequency. So whole frequency, so it's a continuous field. So I am in one dimension with a periodic boundary condition, and I will consider a Hamiltonian of this kind. So Hamiltonian with a cinetic part, quadratic cinetic part, and a negative potential energy, which means that particles interact themselves, attract themselves, and accordingly to the magnitude of P, this attraction can involve the collapse on the particle. Depending on the force of the attraction. So we are in the so-called focusing case. So the square of a modulus of phi denotes the density of particle. So it means that the integration of a L2 modulus is a number of particles, which is finite here. So it's an Hamiltonian system. The Hamiltonian system we can easily derive the canonical equation of a motion for a field separating the real part and imaginary part, and then we derive a so-called nonlinear Schrödinger equation on the torus. With initial data, with those initial data is a configuration of a field. configuration of a microstate where we consider. So formally, the Hamiltonian together with the mass, the L2 norm, the energy in the L2 norm are conserved for this equation. So the point, it's a deterministic equation, and we are interested in with this deterministic equation, but with random initial data, right? It's not really random, I mean, it's initial data drawn from a measure in a functional space. And we will see in the second part how we can approach that by a stochastic PDEs with deterministic data. It's the main links between deterministic PDEs with random initial data and stochastic PDEs with random or not initial data. Now, it's this model is quite general in the physics. In physics, it's quite general. We can the real physics are in dimension three or in dimension two, with a different value of the nonlinearity. So it could be Langmuir waves or nonlinear optics. Nonlinear optics in the focusing case, and Bose-Einstein condensation in the defocusing case, but it's not our subject today. Particularity is that when dimension is equal to two and p is equal to four, the solution, even very regular initially, can collapse in a finite time. Whereas in dimension one, when in the cubic case, so p is equal to four, so cubic nonlinearity, the system is a completely integrable Hamiltonian system, and we have an explicit solution. We can have some explicit solution of the equations. So the it means that if we want to remain in one dimension and to recover behavior in higher dimension, we have to you have to consider nonlinearity greater than four. It's the bet we are doing when we work in dimension one. Dimension one with nonlinearity greater than four, we can have insight of what happens in higher dimension. There are particular solution of this equation, which are ground state or fundamental state of the equation. It's when you are looking for stationary solution of a deterministic equation. So you have a kind of Sturm-Liouville equation to solve with a fixed parameter. And due to the, it's written in R. So I am in a non-compact case on R. So on R, it will give the one parameter family of solution, one continuous parameter of a family of solution, which are the soliton. Alors, Schrödinger is a Galilean invariance with Schrödinger. So it means that you have two parameters here, mu and c, contrary to contrary to KdV or over dispersive nonlinear case. Now, in the compact case, you cannot do that, but the Sturm-Liouville equation have solution only for discrete value of mu. So it's not real soliton, it's a kind of conoidal things, but which converge with the soliton when your interval converges to R. Now, the soliton is interesting in its own because they are so the solution of a minimizing problem. It's a they are the infimum in fact of a minimization of the Hamiltonian with a constant mass. Yes. So it would mean that our Gibbs measure will concentrate at low temperature, the Gibbs measure will be concentrated around the soliton. So what we can do with the solid, we can speak about the stability, orbital stability of this soliton, which means stability. Since Schrödinger is not invariant by translation, but there is a invariant Galilean invariance, it's not a classical orbital stability by translation. It's just you take the infimum over the solution of the infimum of the Hamiltonian. But so the main the main motivation of physicists concerning this equation was at the beginning the recurrence FPU. When we take in fact initial data with those energy is concentrated of low frequency mode, in fact the energy will spread over the frequency, but after a while they come back into the initial setup of frequencies, or in a way almost periodically. So it means like with the initial data, for example, of a sinus, you will get a train of soliton after a while. So it has been the renaissance of Cordevic de Vries equation in the 60s, since people are trying to understand that phenomenon concerning KdV, but also with NLS, we observe the same thing with a cubic nonlinearity in deep water waves. So it's the main point, the main starting point for the study of a JIP measure. In fact, because faced to this recurrence property, we want to apply a kind of infinite dimensional Liouville theorem. The answer will not be exact, because if you apply Liouville theorem, you will have a Poisson recurrence. Poisson recurrence is not a periodical recurrence. Just a Poisson recurrence, but it means there is a sequence of time tending to infinity, such that at those time you will pass near the initial data, but your sequence of time which goes to infinity is not periodic, but it's a beginning. So Liouville theorem, we said that any reasonable function of the Hamiltonian could be the density of invariant measure, but what density with respect to what? We are in functional space, so there is no Lebesgue measure, there's no things like that. And we know that if we restrict ourselves on sphere on L2, when beta tends to infinity, so a low temperature, we know that this thing will concentrate on the soliton, because the ground state minimize the Hamiltonian with L2 norm. So it's why this is the main motivation for the study of such measure. And we can make a parallel between PDE techniques studying deterministic PDE evolution written as an evolution equation using studying the Cauchy problem for initial data. Usually the Cauchy problem for initial data will tell you things about where are the good space, but not where are the good white dynamics. It's like the good space usually is chosen in order to make contraction argument works or compactness argument works, but it doesn't teach us a lot about the interesting dynamics, whereas the Gibbs measure tell us what are the white dynamics. So it's taken from the paper of Leibovitz of the 1888, the first part. We see that with a given mass, like with a given L2 norm in that paper, when the temperature goes from four toward from zero towards four, multiplying by two at each step, we see a concentration, in fact, of a measure around a soliton-like structure. Alors, in fact, it's not. I will explain at the end how this thing is computed. But in fact, we recenter in fact the field in the middle. We recenter the field in the middle of the interval, and we make mean with that. It's why the thing, the peak is centered at 1/2. But it's we make translation at each time. Where is the supremum? And we put the supremum at the middle of the interval, and then we make a mean on that. So there is at high temperature, there is something uniform. At low temperature, we see something emerging. It's the reason of my talk, in fact, today. But I wanted to understand how this thing has been computed, because I can challenge every people here. In the paper of Leibovitz, it's written nowhere what simulation is written, Monte Carlo simulation, the only word which mentioned the numerical scheme behind this. So I wanted to understand why, because we can simulate. At the beginning, I thought that the author simulate Schrödinger, but deterministic Schrödinger, but dispersing nonlinear waves with initial random initial data, and then they make some mean on that expectation, but it's Schrödinger, it's not a parabolic equation, and it's not easy to integrate numerically. So, and afterwards, when I grew up, I read a lot of things about Monte Carlo Markov chain method, and then I think the easiest way to simulate that is to simulate the GIS measure using a Monte Carlo Markov chain method, because it's quite natural. But how to give a sense to that measure first? Because okay, it's written, this thing has not a real sense. So we have to make sense of that. We have to build a reference measure, in fact, a Gaussian measure, and then to compute the density with respect to that Gaussian measure. So, it's a measure in infinite dimensional space. So we have a problem concerning the dimension, the sense to be given to the measure. We have to take into account all the frequencies in the model. Because in the linear case, the Hamiltonian is quadratic. So in the Gibbs measure, everything decouples, all the modes decouple, and then you recover a tensor product of Gaussian measure, a product measure. But in the nonlinear case, it is not a tensor product, because there is interaction between the modes. Now, there is exception, because we can find, it's a very funny story, you can find from, you can find nonlinear equation, Benjamin Bonnat Mahoney equation. It's a kind of, it's a KdV-like equation, a KdV-like equation, which is nonlinear. It's not Schrödinger, but it's also a weakly nonlinear dispersive equation. It's nonlinear, but the Hamiltonian is in fact the square of the H1 norm. So it means that the Gibbs measure is Gaussian for this equation. So it's not. It's not reciprocal. It's not because you are linear, okay, the Gibbs measure is Gaussian, but the reciprocal is not true. So, rapidly speaking, first step, we construct a Wiener measure. We take the kinetic energy, and then we compute the density with respect to what Gaussian measure. Gaussian measure is not a big deal. In fact, there is absolutely no difficulty to construct that on Hilbert space as long as the covariance operator is of twice class. Alors, there is a sombre story about periodic boundary condition of a Laplacian. You know that the kernel is not trivial, so it's not inversible. So we have to take a part, in fact, the Lebesgue part on the zero frequency component. But that part is perfectly normalizable. And now, in fact, you just have to eat the main point of a paper of Leibovitz to compute, to show that the density, the potential part of the Hamiltonian is integrable with respect to this measure. Integrable exactly integrable in the parameter given by the deterministic theory. I mean, until the critical exponent, it's normalizable, and beyond the critical exponent, it's no more normalizable. Critical exponent, it means that you don't have solution of a deterministic solution with this kind of nonlinearity. Alors, if you are interested in the proof of that, you can see the original paper, but there is a much more concise proof in the paper of Bourguin on CMP. Where are the support of this measure? The support of this measure is the same as the support of a linear part, because there is an absolute continuity between the two measures. And the linear part is not difficult to see, but the support of this measure is H1 half minus epsilon, because of that, in fact. The easiest way to see that is to consider random variable and to ask what are the random variable with this kind of measure. So it's a Gaussian variable, and you just compute the variance, and the variance has to be finite only if S is less than 1/2. It's interesting because at that time there was no theory of deterministic theory for initial data in that phase. So it's why Bourguin. It was the beginning of a work of Bourguin to give sense of construct solution Cauchy problem for initial data in that space. So it's history. Now, simulation. So we want to simulate that. So we have a different kind of we can write the measure in different kind. My first move was to use a Monte Carlo MCMC method, Metropolis method, with a proposal given by the Gaussian measure, and then acceptance ratio due with a potential part, which was something natural. But it didn't work at all. So the simplest way to derive the scheme is to first to discretize in space the equation, as in the same way when we construct the measure we construct the measure by discretization, and when we pass to the limit, so it's natural to make the same thing for the simulation. So we discretize, for example, with finite difference method. So we are on the cyclic group, and then we have a discrete Hamiltonian. This discrete Hamiltonian, we have a finite dimensional Hamiltonian system, and this system has a finite dimensional measure, which is an invariant measure thanks to Liouville theorem. Now we will give up the Hamiltonian framework. Now it's not, maybe we can keep the Hamiltonian case in the Langevin with the Langevin method, but with multiplicative noise, maybe, but I don't see it yet. But so I give up completely. I take the linear part, the imaginary part, and then we use a Langevin method in Rn times Rn, which means that we know that the solution of this coupled differential equation with gamma is a given non-negative operator, as P, so our target density, P as an invariant measure because it satisfies the Fokker-Planck equation with gamma. And so at each gamma, we have a different choice of stochastic differential equation. So here, WWGH is a finite dimensional Brownian motion. So, and we can compute the derivative with the Nabla operator on H for each real part in the imaginary part. And we found this, these things. So with different choice, we will have different discretization, but the same law. The same law, and there is an infinite number of possibilities. The first one is to normalize by square root of 2 over h. So it gives something. So it gives here something which will which will behave like a white space time white noise, because we divide it by h, the space parameter. Or, and it's an approximation of a Laplacian minus Laplacian operator, or we divide it by a to the power 1/2, and we recover this thing. It's a kind of precondition, it's a precondition scheme, because here you it's a kind of accommodation of a future time step with a frequency. But there is also other choice. But there is at least these two cases. So if we can take formally, there's best thing to be done, whereby it's not very difficult to take the limit of this equation and to see that there are stochastic reaction diffusion PDEs linked to that problem. But so the Laplacian, a non-linearity, or it's a couple. Either equation one and equation two are two system of couple SPD, couple via modulus via the norm of phi. Alors, WG is a space-time white noise, a Wiener process, cylindrical Wiener process on L2, and W tilde is a Q Wiener process, or Q is A to the power minus one. Now, alors, more generally, Langevin method, it's a way to simulate symmetrizable Markov semigroups. In fact, it's due to the gradient in the drift. In fact, and there is correspondence between SDE with a gradient in the drift and symmetrizable semigroup, symmetrizable Markov process with respect to particular measure M, which is defined here. In fact, it means that the measure M is reversible with respect to the Markov process. So it means that it's automatically an invariant measure. Unfortunately, for practical reason, we have to discretize Langevin. We have to discretize Langevin, and we will introduce a bias doing that. We will introduce a bias because even if we take a small delta t with Langevin, we will converge with our measure, but we will converge after a long time, and we will produce a very correlated sample. So it means that once the ergodicity has been proved, if you want to use ergodicity to compute mean expectation, the autocorrelation, the CTL theorem for Markov chain, the autocorrelation will be too high. And if you put a big delta t, a big delta t, in fact, there will be a big bias on your target. So we need a Metropolis step to for that. What is a Metropolis step? Is a way to project on finite on discrete projecture scheme on discrete time reversible Markov chain. Discrete time reversible Markov chain. It's the aim of a Metropolis step. So it's just a Metropolis Hastings algorithm. Now we turn in infinite dimensional case. So the main ingredient of such algorithm is a proposal. In fact, at each time step, we compute a proposal from phi to psi, and then you accept or not psi. It's based on acceptance ratio. Acceptance ratio. If you want your final chain, the chain you construct it, to be reversible with your target, you need your acceptance ratio to be like that, where nu is your target, so our JIT measure. Now, of course, this thing has to be understood as a Vadon-Nikodym derivative in a functional space. Now, the space discretization will give us the Langevin method. Now, the time discretization will give us proposal for the Metropolis algorithm. And so there are two for each of the equation, the natural one and the condition one, precondition one. We can use a theta scheme. In all generality, we will use a theta scheme in order to compute the proposal. And we will see that, in fact, the good parameter theta will be 1/2. When parameter theta is equal to 1/2, in fact, you have your acceptance ratio as non-trivial value. The acceptance ratio could be the acceptance ratio can be null, vanishes almost surely, or it can be one almost surely, but we just want to have a strictly positive acceptance ratio, mu almost surely and non-trivial. And we can see that in fact the good parameter theta for that is 1/2. Alpha here denote the nonlinearity. We have a choice to put the nonlinearity in the proposal or not. In fact, a part of a nonlinearity could be open proposal, the other part will be in the acceptance ratio. And we have to make after numerical analysis to see if we have convergence. So if we want to have a non-trivial acceptance ratio, in fact, we have to check by the two bivariate distribution that are here are equivalent with that transpose. In fact, when you see the definition of the acceptance ratio, it's exactly it means that. In fact. So there is a literature on that. We see that when theta is different from zero, in fact, those bivariate functions are mutually singular. And so the acceptance ratio is null, mu almost surely. And on the contrary, the two measures are equivalent. So the idea of a proof is quite simple. You just have to find quite simple. Just to see why theta is equal 1/2 is important, you just have to, in the linear case, work with a linear case, because if it works with a linear case, with a suitable Gersenov things, you will have your results. Okay, so you just compare the two, it's Gaussian. In the linear case, everything is Gaussian. It's not difficult to see that the condition, if theta is equal to 1/2, then the block diagonal are equal, and so mu is equal to its transpose. Now, conclusion, doing this thing, in fact, my first computation was to see, to measure concentration. So I simulate nu. And I compute the mean expecting value with respect to nu. C is the space of continuous function with boundary periodic boundary condition, And then if S is large enough, it means that something concentrates somewhere. Right? So 2^4 on the top power. And indeed, we see that when beta with at low temperatures, there is suddenly something which is grows. S, capital S is big. With different value of n. At left, it's n is equal to 80 and n is equal to 30. And the scaling is e beta n to a power minus one. In fact, with beta is I, or when n is I, there is a phase transition. It's the phase transition. The other thing to see that. So here is my simulation. When I wanted to recover the things in the paper of Leibowitz, in fact, I guess I have something which is similar. So why the thing is centered around 1/2? It means that in fact I have translate my phi, every phi I simulate, I translate it around its maximum, and I put the maximum in 1/2, and then I compute the measure. So it's natural to have something in the center. But we see in the, either for n is equal to 13 or 14, 18, there is a phase transition, suddenly phase transition starting from beta is equal to one dot zero twenty four, and before it's flat, and the same in. There is a lot of thing to. So there will be a lot of question now, a lot of question, because the first question is can I get rid of dependence of delta t? I want to get rid of the dependence of delta t with respect to the spatial parameter. Is it true or not? When theta is equal to 1/2, there are good insight for that, but there is still to be proved. The Hamiltonian is not bounded below, so does that mean that there is no spectral gap? But I find that the spectral gap is beyond this case of study. Spectral gap, it means that the Bayesian is bounded below by a constant times there is a curvature. The curvature is bounded below by a constant, independent of the dimension. And in this case, we see that delta t. There is a convergence independently on the space parameter. And also we need the ergodicity results if we want to have SPDs of a parabolic reaction diffusion equation, if we want to compute the mean in the sample. And I mentioned paper which talked about that, where I think there is a lot of material to be used. Voilà.